Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Youth Focus. I'm your host, Deshaunette Prince, and today we'll be discussing the really important topic of police brutality. As you may know, police brutality is a very controversial topic which affects all but mostly minority groups. Today, we are joined by Noche Diaz, Steve Yip, from Stop Mass Incarceration Network. It is a movement to stop the injustice of both mass incarceration and police brutality. We are also joined by Zaira Speller from a social justice group at Democracy Prep Harlem High School. Thank you all for joining us. How are you today?
Good. Thank you for having us.
Fine. Thank you very much.
Yeah. So would you be able to tell us a little bit more about Stop Mass Incarceration?
Sure. So the Stop Mass Incarceration Network was formed in 2011 by Cornel West and Carl Dix to bring together different groupings of people and prominent individuals who had been speaking out about and exposing the crime of generations of black and brown youth who had been treated as a generation of suspects and criminals to be guilty until proven innocent if they survive long enough their encounters with the police to prove their innocence. And they saw the things like Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, doing a lot of exposure about this, and that there was a need to fill of massive determined resistance to oppose this and to actually not just expose it academically, which is very important to bring that to light, but to actually put people's bodies on the line to stand up against this, people who had conviction based on their understanding to actually act to stop this. And the first campaign it launched was to stop and frisk, and I joined shortly after the initiation of the network. I'm part of the Revolution Club here in New York.
I think one thing that's very important in terms of what Noche is speaking about is that one of our key focuses is encapsulated in the slogan, mass incarceration plus silence equals genocide. And this is a message that we've been driving home. But it's not just a messaging, but it's also what Noche has said, we have to build mass determination in terms of opposing this, and this is what our movement's about.
That's very interesting. Zaira, would you be able to tell us about your Friday Social Justice School?
Friday Social Justice is a student-led, student-proposed group that myself and my co-founder proposed to our principal last year, and it's with a focus on speaking about different social injustices that happen to us, and not just speaking about them, but finding solutions to them, coming from a high school perspective, basically.
That's great. So you must be well acquainted with today's topic. To start off, we all know that police brutality has been a hot topic for the past couple of years, and many movements like the Black Lives Matter movement were organized to bring light to the injustices taken upon all over the country. Do you think these movements have been effective, meaning it has helped spread awareness for the inequity of the ways blacks and whites are treated differently by the police force?
Sorry, that was a lot.
All right,
you have to stop.
You want to take that?
No.
Yeah, she's got it. She's getting her thoughts together.
It's just a question.
Do you think these movements have been effective, like with helping blacks and other minorities?
Of course, I think the movement has been effective in ways that are not very linear or always very clear, and like not ways that you can say, okay, this has been done, this has been done, and this has been done, but just the idea of having that a group who's creating a voice for these injustices that people like to act like don't exist, I think is progress within itself, and that's something a lot of people don't like to pay attention to. But me personally, I think that is some type of progress that has been made.
I agree. I feel as though if these movements were not here, like it wouldn't be like we wouldn't have all the things that we have right now. Like I feel like because of these movements, blacks have found blacks and other minorities have found a way to like say their voice and their opinions on other things. Mm-hmm. Would you guys like to add?
Yeah, I mean, there's two kind of elephants in the room. One is that we're here talking about it, right?
Yeah.
Which is, there's, stations and conversations that like this that have gone on a scale and with a depth and determination that would not have existed were it not for the people who had actually acted, especially, I want to say, know, a salute to the youth in places like Ferguson and Baltimore who actually braved a lot of terror to stand up to that in the face of, you know, even a lot of people calling them, you know, no good for standing up in the way that they did. And they really, you know, lit a metaphorical fire, you know, sometimes literal too, but they lit a fire under people to say, look, this is not something you can just ignore anymore. This is not something you can just make a, you know, a nice donation somewhere and then feel good about it. This is not something you're just allowed to walk by and pretend it doesn't happen or it's happening to some other people. We're here, we're human beings, and we're not going to keep on being treated like this. And so that's one, yeah, that is one very important thing that, that, you know, has come out of all this. The other elephant in the room is that the ongoing terror by the police and the criminalization and mass incarceration of people has not stopped.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that is, that is, that is that is the point. It's not to try to, you know, just bring awareness for the sake of awareness or just to get some policy reforms or to get a few more brown and black faces in high places, you know, that are, you know, sort of within the system because, oh, we're not represented by the shot callers and more black and brown police. And no, that's actually not the point. It's to stop this, you know, and I'm tired of seeing, you know, more and more videos. It's good that there's more exposure, you know, that people can see this now, catch these cops red-handed, but the point is not to just see more and more and more videos of the police getting caught doing this and then still going unpunished over and over again. The point is that this has to stop. And, you know, the last thing I'll just say about this question, I think is very important, is that we're, you know, standing at the at a sort of crucible of history right now, where there has been tremendous struggle against this and has accomplished a certain amount in terms of, you know, bringing this to the light, and also, you know, having actually affected some things. You know, we did stop, you know, stop and frisk in its form, in the form that it existed, and when we launched that campaign. But now we're standing at the threshold of the rise of Donald Trump, an American Hitler who has promised to bring back all the hell times 10 and to also go after the people like us who are speaking about and fighting to stop these kinds of things. And we're at a moment right now where we can make a leap by stopping him before it starts, or we're going to be set back in a big way and be fighting under conditions that are much more difficult to even have these kinds of conversations without facing more police repression and brutality.
Ditto. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was a lot. I really agree with what you're saying. Like, yeah. Well, now with that, with saying that, we want to cut a short video of various cases of police brutality that has been that has been shown.
As Seattle resident Christopher Harris walked by a movie theater in 2009, he was suddenly rushed and thrown into a wall by Sheriff's Deputy Matthew Paul. With such tremendous force, it left the 29-year-old man in a severe coma. Paul had mistaken Harris for a robbery suspect. Despite the life-altering injuries Harris sustained, Paul was not charged with any misconduct, and the police department provided a statement saying that he had done nothing wrong. Unsurprisingly, Paul had a history of thoughtless attacks in both police training sessions and in regard to civilian arrests. Months earlier, a man named Jeff Gold provided photographic evidence of injuries he sustained after being taken down by Paul for obstructing an officer, though Gold was not formally charged with any crime. Paul stayed with the police department after the Christopher Harris incident. About 6 years later, the man eventually passed away due to the catastrophic brain injury. The tragic and well-documented killing of Oscar Grant went on to not only inspire riots and protests, but even became a popular award-winning film with Fruitvale Station. After BART police responded to a physical altercation call on the West Oakland station, they came into contact with Grant and his friends, pulling them off the train and questioning them. When Grant learned he was going to be arrested, he protested, only to be thrown to the ground face first and pinned down. He was not checked to see if he was carrying a weapon. As one officer hurled a racial epithet at Grant, a train passenger began to film the event. Grant begged not to be tased as an officer placed his knee down on the young man's neck. Finally, without provocation, Officer Johannes Messerler fired a single shot into the 22-year-old's back. Grant died the next day. Riots and protests filled California streets in the following days, and Messerler was eventually charged and sentenced for murder. Arguably the most altering police brutality case in American history is that of the beating of Rodney King. After a high-speed police chase, King was ordered out of his vehicle and forced to the ground by a taser from one police officer. After a struggle, King is repeatedly bashed and beaten by the batons of four police officers, all of whom opt to continuously attack the man instead of arresting him. King eventually props up to his knees, only to be attacked viciously, again and again. In all, King was hit over 40 times over the course of nearly 2 minutes. The footage of his beating came into view of the public 2 days after the incident and ignited a storm of riots and protests that burned down and destroyed millions of dollars in public and private property. To this day, the King beatings present a warning to officers. No amount of power puts you above the law.
After watching this video, would you be able to share your reaction or your thoughts on how you felt after watching that?
Well, one of the things is very clear, and that's a consistently thing that's brought up by mainstream media, is somehow these things are aberrations, where in fact these things are actually quite common occurrences that take place particularly in black and brown communities, day in, day out.
Yeah.
And they are part of the overall genocidal trend that has been in place for a very long time. And it's not a question of seeking a policy change. It's not a question of tweaking this or retraining officers. The problem here lies within the very root of the system itself, because it's basically fundamentally a system that's historically based on white supremacy, based on exploitation and oppression. And it cannot, it's part of its DNA, it cannot separate itself from this.
Right.
And we're going to see this continuing. And like Noche actually pointed out, we're going to see much more of a world hurt, you know, with the coming of the Donald Trump and Mike Pence regime. And this is something that we need to not only brace ourselves for, but also we need to call on people to say that, understand what the source of this, and that we need to begin to resist this on a very determined way. Just like the people who took, put themselves on the line back in the days of the old Jim Crow, back in the 1950s and 60s, where people actually, who actually put themselves on the line at the Freedom Riders, or the people who actually put themselves on the line at the lunch counter to desegregate it, only to come under vicious beatings and what have you, even killings and firebombings, things like that. We need that determination actually, not only expose this, but also put the system on notice, if you will, that,
yeah,
you know, but also bring out more and more people who are affected day in, day out, and don't know what to do. And this is what the Stop Mass Incarceration Network is about, in terms of addressing these very issues, going to the root of it.
I would say, you know, it's really important, it's part of why I joined in with this Stop Mass Incarceration Network, but I also want to say, the reason I'm a revolutionary and, you know, I follow this guy, Bob Avakian, is because he talks about putting an end to the system that would give rise to and protect police. We do that over and over and over again. And you see, you know, I mean, there's just a few cases there, but it just, you know, echoes and echoes, because, you know, you look this up and you go scroll down and down and down, because it goes on and on and on, and they're never punished. If this was not what they were there to do, I used to get in trouble when I used to drop some food on the floor when I was working in a kitchen. They're killing people. And not only is it they're not being punished, they're being promoted oftentimes, and this is being, you know, like the video said, he did nothing wrong. It's justifiable. This is it's very hard to watch that, and no one should ever get used to it. Because you can see it over and over again and just kind of get used to it, but it's not normal. It's not something people should learn to get used to. It is something that should rip you apart inside and drive you to figure out why and how does it stop.
I totally agree with you, because they have all the evidence that this person had not done anything wrong, yet the police officer was not charged with anything and stuff like that. It just shows, like you said, that nothing, like, America is not just. I just think like that.
Yeah.
Now, many of the victims of police brutality that we hear about tend to be minorities. In your perspective, do you feel that police officers are assigned to target specific races or individuals who fit a particular profile?
I like to speak on that. I would like to say that they don't. They probably don't sit in a conference room and say, okay, so you focus on these people and you focus on these people. I think there is this thing called like a natural implicit bias that people have towards people of color that, as was mentioned before, has it, like, it's a part of the system that has existed for years and years and years, and that's something that you cannot detach from a police officer once you put him into that position. Like, you can't teach somebody not to be biased about a situation. So when they are in the field or like, for example, with the broken police windowing and going around and like on foot and stuff, I think they naturally end up inclined to these neighborhoods where they have this bias about associating black and brown or minorities with negativity and things like that. So I don't think that they sit in a room and say, okay, so we're gonna focus on this group, that group. I think it naturally ends up happening because the idea that people have about people of color is something that is negative. So that's how they're gonna end up reacting when that's their natural thought about us.
I think there's, you know, a lot to learn from about, you know, what is it that goes on in people's heads when they're carrying out this kind of insanity. But I would also say, you know, you don't wake up in the morning a police officer. You sign up for that job, and you're there to play a role in society. And the role that these police have come to play, not because of any one cop, but because of, you know, how history has worked out, the history of this country, and what role the police have come to play. And, you know, we don't have time to go into the whole history of America, but, you know, but there's a long and ugly one. and the modern day incarnations of, you know, of the way in which black people have always been oppressed in this country and exploited, the modern incarnations of that, you know, it's always been enforced with violence and terror, you know, whether it was the slave chasers and the Klansmen or the Knight Riders of the Jim Crow era, and the police today of the new Jim Crow, who actually carry out this kind of terror. It's you know, I don't know about whether or not every single police officer is in his mind a total stone to the bone racist, and it doesn't make a big difference, because if what you're doing is the same thing and you're playing the same role, then the role that you're playing is the problem. And, you know, I would say that role comes from a system that has millions of people with no future. No, you know, there's no even plantations to enslave people on anymore. You just lock them up, treat them all as criminals, let them kill each other, and kill them on top of that, and use that as justification for it all.
Well, I mean, if I can just add what he just brought out, is that fundamentally this society doesn't have a future for black and brown people, particularly for the young people. And not only is it, as Sister pointed out, that, you know, there's a lot of prejudice that's built into society, but you want to know something too? A lot of recent police killings are being done by black and brown police officers. Mm-hmm. So the question is that once they enter the ranks of the police, they are trained to think a certain way. They're trained to think about certain people who are oppressed and those who are the oppressor. Now, it may not come out in those kind of terms, but they're taught to, like, this is society that's based on property relations and property values, and that there are certain people who are disadvantaged, and that maybe that's where crime tends to be germinated from, because people are disadvantaged, and there's a certain way of looking at that. And the question of broken windows or stop and frisk, these are manifestations of those kind of policies in terms of looking at people in terms of they are sort of a pariah people, because the system doesn't know what to do with them. Mm-hmm. There's no more jobs, you know, out there for black and brown youth. All the factories have moved away. It's not black people or brown people's fault that there are no jobs. You know, they didn't do away with the jobs. But society has no solution for it. So their only solution is either mass incarceration, police murder, or go into the military to kill other poor people. This is what the dynamic that we're looking at right now.
Yeah, I agree. I think it does go back to history because, you know, Caucasians have always been the racial group that has always been on top. So I felt as though, like, minorities have, like you said, they don't have any, no place to go. Like, they don't have any jobs. Like, there's certain things that you have to have in order to get those jobs, and I think they were mainly focusing on whites. Caucasians to get those jobs.
White folks. It's fine.
Yeah, I don't want to say. I don't like. There have been many studies that have shown that the NYPD stop and frisk policy has been made. Officers disproportionately go after people of color compared to those of other races. Why do you think this happens, and why do you think there are some things that should be changed in the stop and frisk policy? Zayama.
Can I go back to the question a little bit? Okay, thank you. Okay, so, wait, why do I have to talk to
you? What do you think should be changed about the stop and frisk policy?
I don't think there is anything good about it, like, to start off, because how do you know when to go and search into somebody if it's not based off of a bias that you have about that person? I'm not asking you, but I don't really understand the whole mindset behind it to really speak on it a lot, because I haven't known much about the other opinion, but from what I understand from it, they suspect something and they go and search for it. But I want to know what leads to you suspecting that in the first place, for you to be able to say, okay, I need to go check this person because they might have so-and-so whatever on them. It ends up targeting certain people, and it ends up continuing the system that they want to happen. And I don't think that it should happen at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you feel as though there's no reason for the stop and frisk policy?
I guess the logic behind it is to crack down on, I guess, whatever they think these people may be carrying, but I don't think there is an effective way to carry that out without allowing room for targeting certain groups of people.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I agree with a lot of what you're saying. I mean, I was talking about one of the first things the network came together to do was to stop and frisk, because, it is one of the most clear-cut cases of, this is about targeting black and brown people that say that they're all criminals, it doesn't matter what they're doing. And all the data, all the facts, all the statistics back, it showed that that's all it did. The thinking behind it was again, along with this whole thing of they're all criminals, so make them all scared of the police. I mean, you even had
Ray Kelly?
Kelly, there you go, sorry. I'm getting old. But, he would talk about how he wanted every black and brown youth to walk out the door and be afraid that they will be stopped by the police. This is openly what they talked about in terms of their and they studied things like what goes on in places like Palestine in terms of carrying out counterinsurgency and genocidal programs of controlling whole populations. And this is totally a part of that. And it's a little once again just crazy that we have to even keep on talking about this today. I thought we had settled that question, and here we go. Now it's going to be federal policy, law of the land, stop and frisk everybody. That's what Trump has promised. This is very dangerous and has no other purpose than to criminalize and to provide a thin cover of legitimacy for when the police carry out their more open just brutality, terror, and harassment, little kids who before they're even in high school are thrown up against walls and having their clothes taken off and searched, and this is nothing but humiliation and trying to break a whole people and several people and generations of people.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I feel like as though the stop and frisk policy has not really been effective. I don't really see. I understand the point. I understand the point behind it, but I don't feel as though anything has been done using that policy. I feel as though, like you guys said, it targets specific group, I feel as though, that's what I feel. To date back to 2015, there has been about 940 victims of police brutality this year, according to Washington Post database. 226 of them victims were black, and 155 of them were Hispanic. Last year, 991 people fell victim to police brutality. Although there was a slight decrease in the lives lost at the hands of police officers, Why do you think that the numbers are still so high?
Okay, so regardless of the movements that are happening to date, the opinions of the people who are in these positions, like police officers and attorney generals and stuff like that, their opinions are not changing. They don't feel a different way. So if the people in power are not able to like set the tone for, okay, this is not okay and this is not going to happen, then it's going to keep happening. And the number may have decreased because I guess the Black Lives Matter movement and this idea of social media, mm-hmm. how it's so powerful with everything, and as soon as something happens, the first thing people do is post it on Twitter, post it on Facebook, so everybody sees what's going on. So I think that may be playing a role in how police officers carry out their actions some of the time, because they might be thinking of that consequence, but it's hard to, it's hard to remove that bias away from them at the end of the day.
I would just add, you know, the drop in numbers is very insignificant, and we are dealing with, not only is it still a massive, you know, problem, but the fact that so much has come out where people have seen it over and over again, and that still it is not stopping, right. Or even, you know, even really slowing down, is a very bad situation. I mean, you know, I was in Chicago a couple weeks ago, where another Black man murdered by the police at a funeral procession, you know, where he was already attending the funeral of his cousin. You know, their procession was cut off by an off-duty police officer who then called for an on-duty police officer who came in and shot the man in a funeral who was protecting his cousin who was being harassed by this off-duty police officer. Okay, bad enough. That's still not all of it. The neighborhood and the white community came out, largely, you know, white and largely, you know, people made up of, you know, cop families and things like that, came out and called the family the N-word, called them animals who need to go back to Africa, came with baseball bats and you know, chanting Trump, 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 and Blue Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter. Wow. You know, this is, you know, not only is this ongoing, you know, Black men being lynched by police, but now there's the lynch mobs have been resurrected from the dust, you know, people actually coming out to celebrate. They actually celebrated that he was murdered that way. You know, and this is, you know, this is not good, and it's actually going in a very dangerous direction. And you know, it's, you know, again, a lot has been accomplished by people struggling and fighting, but you know, people too much take the sugar-coated bullet of, you know, they're gonna promise an investigation, or they're gonna promise some reforms and some, you know, body cameras was the big thing when you know, a year ago. And now there's body cameras on all these cops, and they know they can get away with it anyway, even if they're caught on camera. And so you still see now more videos of them carrying out even more grotesque, you know, murders. You know, Philando Castile and Alton Sterling over the summer. You just, you know, and you know, the fact that the body cameras were on these police meant nothing. In one case, the body camera somehow malfunctioned or fell off, and in the other case, the body camera was on, the wife recorded it and it was on video, and everybody could see she pleaded with the cops not to kill him, and told them he had a, you know, mental disability, and you know, they said, no, we're gonna kill him anyway, you know, basically. And so this is where we are, and this is there is a need, you know, for people to who see that as what it is, to not fall for this thing of digging in and trying to fix, you know, one police department here, but to really go back on the offensive the way people were, you know, a year ago and in the year before that, where people were actually setting the stage and saying, no, we're actually going to fight to stop this, and everybody's going to have to confront this, and no, we're not, this is not about, oh, did he have a gun? No, this is an epidemic of ongoing murder and terror, and this, you know, I don't care how many times your courts won't prosecute them. They never prosecuted the white men who hung Black men off of trees either. But that does not make it right, okay, or something that people should learn to accept, or that is, you know, justifiable.
Yeah, it's really systemic, and it really comes down to what kind of society, what kind of system that we live under, that would not only perpetrate these atrocities, but what's also very telling is that again and again, these police, and they could even be Black or Latino, they're walking, they're getting away with it, and we can just see this the last couple of weeks. In terms of what happened, that case in North Carolina. In fact, there's two cases in North Carolina, and there's so many I can't remember their names. One was shot in a running way, Walter Scott. Another, the other brother was named Scott also, and he was the one who Keith Lamont Scott. And both of them were, you know, both the police were exonerated, and we can go on and on. They always find some reason to let these cops go. And this gets to the heart of what is wrong with this society, because they cannot allow their police to basically be prosecuted for these kinds of crimes against the people, because they need to have them on the streets to doing what they're doing to maintain that kind of social control. And frankly speaking, it's social control under the gun. Mm-hmm. And that's why we need to actually be determined in terms of how we need to draw a very sharp line, especially now what Noche is laying out in terms of, like, we are looking at a world hurt with the coming of the Trump and Pence regime. It's something that we need to take very seriously.
Wow, that was a lot to take in, especially with your story about the funeral. So do you guys believe that police officers have too much power over the citizens or the civilians? You do?
I mean, we're here talking about, you know, 12-year-old kid in Cleveland gets blown away playing in a park. You know, we're talking about, you know, Deborah Dana in the Bronx, you know, her home broken into and murdered in her home. I mean, this is just an open reign of terror on Black folk and Latinos. And, you know, I would say that, you know, I think a lot of what we've already said kind of speaks to how we feel about what power they have. I would say, though, just, you know, from my perspective, I don't think it's just a question of too much or too little. I think the power that they have over people is, you know, and this system that has power over people is an inhuman system. And that's why, again, when the police carry this out, they're protected, they're exonerated over and over again, because there's a system in place that has no future for people, and they need their police doing what they do. And that's why, you know, from my perspective, I join with a lot of people to fight this, but I'm about getting to a whole different society. You know, our leader, that Bob Avakian, that I told you about, says when we have a new society, our police will have power, and they'll, you know, to protect people, and they would sooner take a bullet and die themselves than to actually carry out this kind of terror. So I would say, you know, yes, they have too much power over people, but it's not just a question of how much power is invested in the authorities. It's what are they there to do? What role are they playing? What system, what society are they actually holding together? This is a white supremacist society that they're keeping going.
So, like, what do you think that civilians can do to get this, like, not the same, but, like, you know, you said they're overpowered, so can you, I don't know how to say this, to ensure that the authority doesn't have, like, a lot of power?
What do we do about this?
Yeah, basically, yeah.
But before I keep on going, if anybody else wants to go in, or maybe just speak after me, because I'll say there's three things people should do right now, okay? If they're feeling deeply about this. First, I would say, go to refusefascism.org, because if Donald Trump is allowed to consolidate power and implement everything he's promised, our ability to do anything about this is going to be far, far, you know, far less, and what we're going to have to be dealing with is actually far worse. And so there's a moment now that people should seize on to actually do something about this. Second, I would say, you know, go to the stopmassincarceration.net, because, you know, it actually makes a difference if people are gathering together and joining together in massive determined resistance, calling this out for what it is, not appealing to the people carrying out, but appealing to the people who don't want to see this keep on going on, to actually build the kind of resistance that's needed to stop this. And I would say the third thing is people should go to revcom.us and check out the Revolution and the Revolution Club. We have these points of attention that say one of the things that we do not tolerate and put up with is when this system and its police use violence against the people. And we'd also struggle against things like, you know, men degrading and disrespecting women and people of different, you know, disrespecting different nationalities and just being out for themselves. But we don't tolerate and put up with when the police are running through our neighborhoods and carrying out this kind of terror, because they have no right, legal or moral or otherwise, to run through roughshod over a neighborhood like an occupying army and not face people who are fighting back and resisting. And the Revolution Club that I'm part of here in New York is part of leading people to actually stand up to that and not just protest or appeal, but to actually, you know, put ourselves, you know, in the way of that and say, no, look, you have no right to do this. We're going to call out other masses of people to come out and oppose you and stop you from being able to carry out your violence and your terror, because people need to get organized to, you know, what we call fight the power and transform the people and their thinking in society to get ready for a revolution where we have, you know, our chance to go up against this system and it, what it does to enforce people. So, you know, people can learn about the club and the revolution at revcom.us and the other two websites I mentioned about what, you know, what we need to all come together on right now, or we're going to be in a world of hurt.
We know that you have had some experience with police officers, so how would you describe your worst experience with the police, and how did you handle the situation?
Oh, man. That's a hard question, you know, honestly, because I'm still sitting in this chair, and I've seen so much, and I've worked with so many families, I've been to so many funerals of people who are not here anymore. And so to s- you know, it's one of those things where to talk about how bad I've been treated in any one case is almost it almost isn't even that important to me anymore because I'm thinking about, you know, the kind of things that people face far, you know, on a far worse scale than you know anyone alive ever will, because you're still alive. But you know that, you know, you grow up. Like I'll say this. I was 10 years old when I remember, you know, I didn't know who it was, but Amadou Diallo was shot around the corner from where I lived and was staying. And I just remember 10 years old hearing everybody in the house talking about, you know, this guy who was, you know, right in front of his home and was doing everything right, trying to show the police that he was, you know, he belonged there and this is where he lived. And they blew him away 41 times. And, you know, 10 years old, and I learned the lesson, okay, that's the world you live in, is at any point you interact with a cop and, you know, for any reason or no reason at all, you can be blown away. And, you know, that's, you know, it's not something I knew about or you know, I actually took me a long time to even learn that the story was Amadou Diallo's, you know, and I learned that it wasn't an isolated incident, but it's part of, you know, I tell the story to just give, you know, to share that, like, there's generations of people growing up under a reign of terror, and it's not like it's always one incident that you learn, but it's something that you learn early on and then again and again and again, that your place is that you're viewed, looked at as a criminal, a suspect, you're guilty until proven innocent, you live in a world that has no future for you, and they're gonna tell you that in a thousand ways every day. And, you know, it's not just one experience.
What do you think should be changed in the training of police officers? Like, do you think there's anything that can be changed?
Well, fundamentally, frankly, what needs to change is that we need, I have to say, we really need a revolution in society, fundamentally speaking, because nothing tweaking or training police officers is not going to really change anything fundamentally. After Amadou Diallo was killed, they talked about training, and, you know, they had all these kind of sessions with the police. Because Amadou Diallo was an African immigrant, they had this African group come in and do some sensitivity training. But frankly, what change has really taken place? Mm-hmm. Because Amadou Diallo was killed by a unit of cops called a street crimes unit. And they, at that particular time, were stopping and frisking people at a rate of about 60,000 a year. 60,000, okay? When after Amadou Diallo was killed, they announced that they were going to reform the police with new training, so that it wasn't just a specialized police unit that was stopping and frisking people, but everyone, all the police officers, would be doing it. And became, it sort of made it sound like very democratic. And what actually happened is that in the past several years is that stop and frisk as a particular tactic by the police grew from 60,000 to more than 600,000 per year. So, you know, we were talking just about that. This is an example of so-called reforms that take place. So the training, you know, really doesn't go anywhere, because fundamentally the system is going to reinvent itself. And because it needs to maintain that kind of relationship of one of the oppressor, being the police, are they are basically enforcers of policy. They represent policy. They don't make policy. They actually execute policy. And so this is what's going on in society overall, not just in New York City, not just in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, not just in Oakland, California, or some other place, Chicago, Illinois. We find this across the board, and this is what's going on. And that is, and frankly speaking, it's not a question of training, because they will reinvent it so that they will exercise their social control under the baton, under the gun, whatever means that they can find. So they will come up with new names for it, and they might actually have certain showcase communities to show something, but ultimately it's going to come back to the same thing.
I agree that it will reinvent itself, but I feel as though, like, one thing that can be changed in the police training is, like, I know that some police officers, like, specifically the minorities who mm-hmm. try out to be a police officer, like, they are the ones targeted by other, like, they are made fun of and stuff like that. So what do you think can be done to ensure that police officers who speak up against, like, police brutality are not, like, backlashed and make fun of and stuff like that?
But did we all have a lot of
opinion? Well, first of all, I think regardless if they speak up or not, they're going to be backlashed, because there's never been a time where somebody has said something that somebody disagreed with or agreed with. Like, nobody's ever going to be on the same page about one thing. So what we can do to help them once they are backlashed is support them, just how we supported our peers throughout this Black Lives Matter movement, and just keep supporting them and encouraging them to keep speaking out against it. Because if they can possibly be that the catalyst for the change within their specific division, you never know. So just keep supporting them and helping them, and make sure they're not discouraged when they are speaking out against police brutality.
I would say, you know, I think there's some things in there to look at, you know, including, like, it's true when there's thousands and tens of thousands of people in the street saying police murder and terror must stop, that should be the most favorable time for any cop who doesn't want that to go on to come out and speak out. Mm-hmm. You know, we didn't see that much of it. You know, there were some people who broke rank and did do some of the things, and they faced a lot of, you know, their fellow cops coming down on them, you know, because you have to learn that once again it's not just a bad cop doing a bad thing, but you're dealing with a whole force that is playing a certain role. So I would say people, you know, need to continue to actually be calling it for what it is. It's murder, it's terror, it needs to stop, and that creates the most favorable conditions for if there's some good person in the police officer, you know, however they ended up there, it's not too late for them to do the right thing and actually come over to the side of the people who are fighting to stop this. And the most favorable conditions for that is massive resistance and people calling it out for what it is and fighting to stop it. And you know, you do have, I mean, Chicago, I was mentioning Chicago, you did have a couple of these cops who came out and did a large exposure of the role of the police in Chicago in the whole, you know, orchestrating and organizing the whole drug trade and the gang wars that were going on there, and you know, on top of 1,000 other crimes that they were committing, and they faced all kinds of, you know, attacks for that. But, you know, some, you know, Adrian Schoolcraft, stop and frisk, he came out and exposed a lot of that. Point is, you know, you can be rehabilitated if you're a pig by stop doing it, get out of what you're doing, and actually be part of the people who are fighting to stop it, expose it, and actually, you know, stop doing what you're doing, because there's no way within that thing that you can actually be part of doing that.
Objectively, so-called good cops are actually complicit. Just straight up, they're just complicit, you know. This, you know, when Rodney King was being beaten, there were 4 cops beating him. There were 20 cops watching.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah. Okay. Did any of those cops speak up? When Anthony Baez was strangled to death in 1994 because he was playing touch football in front of his parents' house in the Bronx, and the football hit the windshield of a cop car, that cop came out and strangled him. There were 6 other cops watching. Okay, did they do anything? In that case, actually one cop eventually spoke out against it. Her name was Daisy Frentis. She was drummed out of the police department. She was getting death threats on her phone, and when she hit *69, those phone calls came from the very same precinct that she worked in. So we're saying that this is ingrained in this culture. It's not just a culture, but these people are actually trained to think a certain way, and this is what the danger we face day in, day out. And we should not self-deceive ourselves in terms of whether or not we can reform them or retrain them. And it's a question like he said, you know, if you really stand with the people, you need to quit. Straight up, you know, you need to quit.
In the media, there are often times when victims of police brutality are portrayed in a negative light, like Mike Brown, Trayvon Martin, and many other victims. They have had images of them throwing up like gang signs and stuff of them doing something that compromises their image released by the media. It is like, it's obvious that these images might sway the public's opinion on these individuals and make it seem as though they were deserving their attack. But with all of this in mind, how do you feel about this and what should be done about it?
I feel like portraying, they're trying to justify what they've done to hurt these people, but regardless of a person's past, there should be no reason to sit there and kill them. Straight up, like, there's no reason to do it at all. That's regardless of what they would have, might have done, if they were stealing cigarettes, selling cigarettes, whatever situation would have been, there's no reason for you to sit there and take somebody's life. So whatever the media tries to put out to justify them or try to make the police seem like, oh, they were taking away our enemy or something, or try to portray them as an enemy, like, they're not doing anything for me. They're not changing my opinion about the reason why these young men were killed. They shouldn't have been killed at all. So I just don't agree with what they're doing.
That's a very important point you're raising, and that's a certain point that we need to actually drive home to people, because people are deterred and derailed from really thinking straight about these questions. It doesn't mean, just because maybe someone did have a criminal record, did it have any bearing in terms of why they should be executed outright in the street? You know, do cops have the right to just kill people? Basically, what the media does when they come in to do these things, like, oh yeah, he has a record, or he was caught, you know, stealing cigarettes and stuff like that, is that justification for killing somebody or shooting them in the back? That's very important, because this is a process of criminalization, demonization of the peoples. It's not a particular individual. We're talking about criminalization and demonization of a peoples. You know, you're a black youth, you're a brown youth, therefore you are guilty. And therefore, if I, as a cop, kill you, I'm totally justified, you know, regardless of what the circumstances may be. And we just saw, like, you know, in that video that I was shown earlier, you know, I saw examples of two Caucasian men being brutalized by police, you know, and those cops walked. But it's much more vicious, even more so when we examine how this is visited upon, particularly minority communities. And it's not just black and brown communities too, we're talking about immigrant communities. Now we're talking about Muslim communities, South Asian communities, Arab communities, you know, and frankly, even white people too. And let's be clear, you know, this is the atmosphere that's building up right now. We're seeing racist, openly racist, backward mobs being unleashed by what's going on. And we need to be very concerned, you know, about what that, but also those people who really hate what's going on, you need to step forward. You need to come forward and actually be part of that resistance. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't have to agree everything what Noche says, you don't have to agree everything what I say, but the question, you think this is a violation of humanity, step forward, we need to step forward.
Yeah, I really love what you said. I mean, the thing of, it shouldn't matter what they've done. They were doing nothing, they didn't deserve to be killed. You know, I would just, you know, I would also add, you know, it doesn't, we know here that when they say that about people, they're trying to just justify this brutal murder. But you also have the situation where, you know, this is part of why you have Trump and all of his followers, you know, celebrating the murder of a black man and viewing every black person, every immigrant person as a criminal, you know, who deserves everything they have coming to them. And it is because people are brainwashed from birth, you know, or trained in a white supremacist, you know, society to hate people of color. And this is dangerous, and it does you know, give whole backing to this, you know, really neo-Nazi kind of movement that is you know, behind mm-hmm. Trump. And so there's no just sort of getting around it. That has to be confronted too, and which is also what we did in Chicago. We actually went down there and confronted the people who stood out, because you know, this has to be confronted with truth and with people resisting. And you know, that just what you said was really.
Yeah, I agree, because like you said before, it doesn't matter if they have a criminal record. And you also said how they use body cameras now on police officers. So all the evidence is there that the victim did nothing wrong, yet the police officers still are let off, whatever. Mm-hmm. And also, like you said, I don't think them putting those pictures out there like is okay. Like I feel as though that's not necessary to do, because when they show the victim and then they show the person who did it, it's not like, it makes it look like they deserved what they got, like what they got coming. They thought. Before I wrap up, do you guys have any closing statements that you want to say before the show is over?
I'd just like to say, all we have to do is get together and continue to fight for what the rights that we are given and we deserve, and hopefully eventually we'll get everything that we've been working for.
Okay.
Well, I just want to say, you know, it's been great. It's very inspiring to see, you know, the two of you and this whole project, that people are actually, you know, engaged with the larger world beyond, you know, just themselves and their Facebook and Instagram. And, you know, it's a very inspiring thing. And I would just say we've talked about a lot of heavy things and a lot of ugly in the world. But you know, there is the potential for humanity to get something to a whole different place. There's a potential for something beautiful to come out of this. And you know, we do have to fight. We do have to do a lot of truth telling. There's gonna have to be a lot of struggle and sacrifice. And you know, the reason I wear this shirt and talk about revolution and Baba Vakin is because I've seen people fight for a long time, and I know people have been fighting before me. We have to figure out how to win. We have to figure out how do we actually not just fight generation after generation and pass this struggle on to the next. So as we're fighting together, we need to be arguing about what's the problem and what's the solution. And you know, I would encourage people to go to revcom.us and really get into, there's a strategy for how we can make a revolution, what we need to do now in a way that we can run a whole different society.
Revcom.us.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, on behalf of the Stop Mass Incarceration Network, let me just repeat that. Mass incarceration plus silence equals genocide, but also I want to steal from him, is that fight the power and transform the people for revolution. So thanks.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Thank you all again for coming here, speaking your side. That is unfortunately all we have for today on the Youth Focus. I'm Deshanette Prince, and I hope you have all gained insight on this topic and feel inspired to join a local organization to fight against police brutality. You have the power to make a change. And thank you all again for joining me, and thank you for watching.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah.